is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host, and we have an awesome topic for you today. You probably saw the title. It's titled Strategies to Successfully Reactivate Past Due Hygiene Patients. You know, every practice has this dilemma where patients are kind of they're patients of the practice, but they just aren't as faithful as we'd like them to be. And this podcast episode is loaded with all kinds of tips and strategies to get more of those patients active in your practice. Hey, before we get to that though, a quick announcement. Coming up on October 23rd and 24th, a couple weeks from the time, a little more than 2 weeks from the time this episode airs, we're doing our Thriving Dentist MBA workshop. We do those in live stream format. Half of the workshop is on Friday, the 23rd. The other half is on Saturday, the 24th of October. In that workshop, I cover the 10 elements of a thriving practice. We go through each one of those elements in depth. And because we run this as a workshop, we also do 11 different exercises during the day. And the purpose of the exercises is to bring the information to life to help you actually apply the information in your practice. We've gotten great feedback. Our team has put together an incredible workbook. I want to say that it's 64 pages and building. We constantly add to it. And it is literally a resource that will get well-used and well-worn in your practice as you work on applying those 10 elements of a thriving practice. Hey, come join us. You can go to thrivingdentist.com/MBA. You'll find that the tuition is very affordable because we do those in live stream format. And we've also received great feedback from our attendees about the live stream format, the convenience of being in your own home, the ability to have all your favorite foods and comforts around you, and the fact that they didn't have to go through TSA and airplane travel and all of the hassle and inconvenience of that. They could simply be at home and or work and take advantage of the MBA live stream workshop. Come join us. Look forward to seeing you at that workshop. Well, now let's shift gears and talk about strategies to successfully reactivate past due hygiene patients.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Coaching in Action segment of the Thriving Dentist Show. This is Naren, your co-host. In today's Coaching in Action segment, we are going to be talking about strategies to successfully reactivate past due hygiene patients. Here, Gary will discuss the importance of having a system and how you can create it, how you can leverage it so you can reactivate all those patients perhaps you haven't seen for a long time, maybe 6 months, 1 year, even 2 years. Gary, let's jump in.
Yeah, Naren, here's where I want to start with that. And you're a wonderful voice on this one. And it's, to me, it there's an irony here. And let me start with that irony. Most dentists spend a lot of time and money to attract new patients to their practice. And if they're wise, they use Equa. I'll just lay it on the table. They use your digital marketing agency to attract quality new patients. And of course, you appreciate that, right, Naren?
Absolutely.
But isn't it interesting that most dentists are very willing to invest in more new patients. And yet every practice I know has a universe of existing patients in their practice that are less active or moving towards inactive. And I think there's plenty of business studies out there that show that it costs you less to keep, and I'll use business terms here, and then we'll transfer it to dentistry. It costs a business less to keep an existing customer than it does to create a new one. Are you familiar with that thinking and familiar with in business?
Yes.
It costs you less to keep an existing one than it does to attract a new one.
100% get it. Yes.
And the same is true in dentistry, that it costs you less to keep an existing patient who, by the way, probably already knows, likes, and trusts you.
Right.
Now, maybe not as much as your loyal ones, but they probably already have some level of liking, trust, and appreciation for you. Is that a fair statement, Naren?
Absolutely. Especially if your practice is relationship driven, definitely they would have, know, like, and trust for sure.
And the reason they've drifted away isn't because they don't know, like, and trust you.
Yeah.
It's life. It's this merry-go-round that we're on. You know, when we do reactivation, and I listen to these, when we do reactivation, you know, Carly might say, if it was you, you know, and let's say, you know, we do it different ways. We can do it by text, we can do it by email, but we can do it by phone. Let's say it was a phone call and she might be said, "Hey, Naren, this is Carly at your dental office. And I just realized, we like to keep track of our patients, and I just realized it's been a while since I've seen you." I often hear the patient say, "Oh no, I was just there." Right. And then, you know, Carly will say, "Well, let's see. Actually, Naren, you're right. You were here, but it was in late 2017. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden the patient doesn't, "Oh no, you're not right, Carly." Every time it's like, "Oh my gosh, you're right. Has it been that long? I'm so embarrassed." You know? And so I don't think there's any malice or there's any intentional avoidance. It's just this merry-go-round of life that we're on, you know, causes distraction. And all of a sudden, we know we're supposed to come in twice a year, but all of a sudden it's 2 years later and they haven't been in for an appointment. So they already know, like, and trust us, some at a greater degree than others. And it's a lot less expensive to reactivate those existing patients. And we're already probably well on the way of establishing rapport, relationship with those patients. Where with a new patient, we've got to start from scratch. So, Naren, as much, I've got to say this delicately, I'm tiptoeing on eggshells a little bit here. As much as I appreciate all the amazing work Equa does, and we need new patient flow, but I think you can be objective about this and say, when your clients reactivate their existing patients too. You're objective in that voice.
100% Gary. I'm 100% for, you know, reactivating patients. I mean, like, I have had times where maybe I haven't seen my dentist for 8 months, 9 months, and my dentist is amazing. You know, they follow up with me, they check in with me, and get me back on the routine, get me back on the schedule. And in my case, I do have some, you know, challenges with gum disease. So if I don't take care of them and if I don't have routine cleanings, it gets really bad. So I see it as almost like a service they do for me. You know, it's like they are looking out for me, even when once in a while I get lazy and I get, I go off the track.
You know, the way I like to think about this, let's say, doctor, you're in a smaller town, you know, smaller city, smaller town, and you're in the grocery store, and you see a patient that patient still thinks of you as their dentist, and they haven't been in your office in 3 or 4 years. But right. They, "Oh, there's my dentist."
Right.
"There's my dentist."
Right.
It's not like, "There's my former dentist."
Yeah.
"There's my dentist I used to see, and now I don't." They don't think I'm that. No, "There's my dentist." And yet they haven't been in your office. And if you think of it that way, the universe of patients, you know, Dr. Reed, Omar Reed, who I talk about, you know, often on this podcast because of his mentor influence on me, said this in 1980 when I met him. He said, "Gary, most dentists are file cabinet millionaires." This is in 1980 dollars. Meaning if you could only get your existing patients to accept the treatment that you've recommended for them, you don't have to rely on new patients.
You know, I love the mindset, Gary. I know we have these conversations with a lot of dentists. You know, the minute it becomes about money, the team is not motivated and they just feel like, you know, they're just going through motions. So I think you always pull it back to purpose. And I love the way you said it. They don't say, "This is my former dentist." They think of you as, "This is my dentist." So you are being, you're doing right by them by getting them back in the chair and keeping their teeth clean. You know, it's just, it's like almost like, you know, it's like, I know, like, you know, if you are having, you know, chronic illnesses like diabetes and stuff, they'll make you do a blood test every so often, right? I mean, even if you forget, somebody's going to be calling you and saying, "Buddy, you haven't done your blood test. You need to get it done and I need to see you," you know? So it's kind of like that.
You know how I feel about the word champion. You know, I love the word champion. We have, you know, our Google review champion. We have our whitening champion. We have our doctor scheduling coordinating champion. We have our hygiene scheduling coordinator champion. I want every doctor to add a new title to their business card. Of course, they're a DDS or a DMD, but the new title is you are the champion of your patient's oral health.
Yeah.
Of their oral health. And I want you to take that role seriously. It's not casual. Right. You're their champion. And that's what this project, we know, Naren, if we can reactivate the patient in hygiene.
Right.
And we'll obviously be doing exams. And one of the cool, I always like to tell patients that if they stay on a regular schedule with us, and that will vary depending on their health. It could be 3 months, 4 months, 6 months. But if they visit us on a regular schedule, we accomplish two things. We keep them as healthy as possible, and we reduce their future dental expenses. And the way we do that is because you're finding things early before they become much more complicated. You know, if a filling is failing, we can replace that with another filling. If we wait till, that decay progresses, that treatment could end up being a root canal and crown. So, which I always like to say, that's good for us, but not good for you, as a patient. So yeah, doctors, think of yourself from this moment forward as the champion of your patient's oral health, which by the way, also has a very important role in their overall health. Well, hey, let's dive into some key metrics here. And this is following the Stephen Covey concept of begin with the end in mind. Let's talk about the goal line, the finish line, what this looks like as we reactivate more patients. And I'm going to call these key hygiene department metrics. And I've got four to share with our listeners. I'll number them 1 through 4. They're equally important. Number one, I'd encourage you, doctor, to create a goal from this day forward that your hygiene department production is 33% or more of your total office production. So at least 1/3 of your total practice production comes from hygiene. Just another way to say that. What counts as hygiene production? Everything that happens in the hygiene room with the exception of the doctor exam. So we do count in this, for this metric, we do count x-rays, even if an assistant takes the x-rays. We count any ancillary services we do like fluoride, sealants, those kind of things. And Naren, just to benchmark this, you know, we share some common clients.
Yeah.
And I get to see some data from you on marketing. You get to see some data from us on practice performance. It's not unusual to see a practice at 16% of the total production comes from hygiene, 20%. And that office has so much more potential if we can build the hygiene department to full potential. So from this day forward, make your goal 33% or more of your total production come from hygiene. Metric number two. I want you to embrace a goal of filling 92% or more of your available hygiene appointments each month, 92% or more. Now, you might be saying, well, Gary, why isn't our goal 100%? Well, it's just not realistic. Right. I want to have realistic goals, but 92% is realistic. And just to show you how realistic it is, last year in my own practice, my lifestyles practice, we were at 97% for the year. So Naren, if 92% is an A, what's 97%?
A plus.
But you see it again in showing the we often see it in our mutual clients where on a given month, they filled 75% of the hygiene appointments, 78%, yeah. Way under. That means that we have a tremendous opportunity to fill in those gaps. Metric number three. We want 85% of your entire patient base involved in active recare in your practice. We used to call that word recall. Recall, I never have liked that word, Naren, because that's what Detroit does for bad cars. They recall them. So I like to use a different word, recare. So 85%. And again, why isn't that 100%? Simply practicality and reality. You're never going to get 100% of your patients on board. But we can get 85% of them. And by the way, that's an easy thing to test in your practice management software and take a look. And we often see with clients, we're at 67, an office might be at 67%, 68%, 60%, 70%, not 85. And that's because they don't have a good system to reactivate people as they slip away. And then finally, one more metric. When the patient's in your office, we generally like to reappoint that patient for their next hygiene appointment, whether that be 3, 4, or 6 months down the road. Agreed?
Yes.
But the goal is not 100%. Because not everybody is hardwired to be faithful about keeping an appointment they're going to make in 6 months. So the goal is 90% reappointment. When they're in your office, 90% reappointment. And Aaron, I had a chance to look ahead in this recording, and we have questions. We have five questions from our listeners.
Yes.
And one of our questions has to do with, what are the verbal skills we should use when we talk to the patient about their next appointment? Because he said, I don't think we're doing it right. What are the verbal skills we should use? So a little sneak preview of coming attractions in this episode. I'm going to share with you the great verbal skills to use and what absolutely never to say. Never to say. I think you're going to like that one. Well, there's the four... That's coming up. That's coming up in the Thriving Dentist Q&A. It's coming up in this episode. So stay tuned. Aaron, now let's get really tactical and talk about what can our listeners, what is the strategy to reactivate? You know, what are we going to do? And let me walk through. It's a multidimensional solution. It's not just one thing. It's a combination of about five or six things that you do. So you know you're absolutely rocking reactivating your patients. And don't feel bad. Don't embrace this as you're bummed out that you have to do this. Embrace it as an opportunity. And I'm going to bring it back to what you said. It's an opportunity of purpose.
Yeah.
It's an opportunity for you to help more patients. Doctor, why did you choose to become a dentist? I'll bet the answer 99% of the time is you want to help people.
Exactly.
How committed are you? What if they start to fall off the bus? Are you just going to give up on them?
Yeah, it's like a kid who doesn't brush their teeth. If you're a parent, are you going to say, well, yeah, I don't
care? I tried.
Yeah.
No, this is where I want you to raise your commitment level, doctor. How committed are you? I mean, think about this, Aaron. Imagine that I was a cardiologist. Instead of dentists, they're cardiologists. And if a cardiologist, let's say they knew the patient had a problem, mm-hmm. and the cardiologist knew what they could do to help the patient with their problem. And the patient wasn't quite with it. Oh, well, I tried. No, they're not going to stop there because
exactly.
when we're dealing with heart, you know, it could be life and death at some point if they don't address it. They're going to sit down and really attempt to influence you in a positive way. So I want to use the same kind of concept here. So let's talk some of these strategies. Number one. I want to encourage you to assign a dedicated hygiene scheduling coordinator. One of your business team members need to be the dedicated hygiene scheduling coordinator. Now, oftentimes, if your office has multiple business office or front office team members, I say, well, we all do that. Aaron, what happens when they all do it?
Nobody's doing it.
Nobody's doing it. And I don't mean that's not meant to be mean or not meant to be cynical, but everybody assumes everybody else is doing it. It doesn't happen. So I want you to assign one. We have a hygiene schedule. We teach our clients. I want one. Now, it doesn't mean they have to do it. Like I'm thinking of a client that has three business team members. All three of them can make hygiene appointments. All three of them can make doctor appointments. All three of them can collect over-the-counter payment. But we have a hygiene scheduling coordinator that is responsible for those metrics in hygiene.
Right. The four metrics you outlined, right?
Right. Which leads me to the next strategy. Share those metrics with your hygiene scheduling coordinator.
Mm.
He or she can help you get there if they don't know where there is. You know, imagine they're a pilot taking off and they don't have a flight plan. Where's the plane going to go? Wherever they want, wherever it wants. You got to give the hygiene scheduling coordinator a flight plan. And it's those four metrics. Now, this leads me into the third recommendation. Consider an individual bonus for your hygiene scheduling coordinator. And I would suggest one very specific one because it's easy to do and it results. If you do this one, the others will happen. It's the 92% filled hygiene appointment goal. So here's what we teach our clients to do. And you can use whatever dollar amount you like that fits your budget. I'm going to suggest the number that we most routinely see, but you're welcome to plug the number in with whatever your budget works for and whatever you feel comfortable with. So we bonus the hygiene scheduling coordinator if at the end of the month, they're at 92% or more filled, kept appointments of the available hygiene appointments. So Naren, let's get real granular about this. If the office had 100 available hygiene appointments for the month, I'm just picking a round number, 100. If 92 or more patients filled those, were kept appointments for those 100 appointments, she's going to get a bonus. And the dollar amount we suggest is $250. Now, we do a second level. If she gets to 95% or above, we double the bonus to $500 a month. Now, if a doctor is sitting there thinking, wait a minute, I don't know if I can afford that. If they did that every month, that's $6,000 for the year. I don't know if I can do that. Let me help you look at this a different way. The average hygiene appointment in the United States is worth about $150. And that includes the prophy, the exams, the x-rays. You know, some will be worth more than that, but that's a conservative number, at least $150. So if we fill some open hygiene appointments, how many more butts in the seats do I have to do? If every appointment's worth $150, how many more, Naren, do I have to do to pay her $250?
Two.
Not even. It's like, yeah.
One in
three quarters.
Yeah, exactly.
How about $500 for the double bonus? So do the quick math on that. How many more do I have?
Three and a quarter.
Yeah, at four, we're there.
Yeah, exactly.
And the reality is when you look at your numbers, they're not filling two or three to get to those numbers. They're adding another 15, 20, 30 appointments. Exactly. To make this number. So it pays for itself. This is where the bonus really works like I like it to, which is where it aligns the goal of the doctor with the goal of our team member. So strategy number three, consider that. And hey, I'd be respectful if for whatever reason you didn't want to do that, but I will tell you, we see it working. And Naren, you get to see it in our mutual clients.
Yeah.
Would you independently corroborate that what I'm telling you?
100%. I mean, just to kind of something that you taught me is you cap the employee expenses, the team expenses at 28%. So you are okay with giving up to 20% of the extra money to the team as a bonus. So in this case, they get an extra 30% per patients, and they only need 3.25 to make it work, meaning to cover the extra bonus. So they're getting almost 9 times what they paid the scheduling coordinator, the hygiene scheduling coordinator. So not only does the hygienist is winning, but the doctor is winning. Everybody's winning. So this is awesome.
Naren, you know, it kind of reminds me, we have a relatively recent past episode all about bonus systems. Let's put that in the show notes because we often get new listeners that are joining in. They're just jumping in, you know, jump in the pool. The water's warm. You know, they're jumping in the Thriving Dentist pool and they're not familiar with the archived episodes. Let's put that in the show notes because we talk about four different types of bonuses and the individual bonus is one of those types. But let's put that in the show notes so that if someone's new to the Thriving Dentist show, they can get a greater context of bonus. Now, let me keep going. Fourth strategy. I want, if you aren't already doing this, I want you to embrace technology to reactivate hygiene, past due hygiene patients. Use email, use text. You in some systems have auto phone messages, that can be done in an automated way. You know, I know Solution Reach is one of those systems that can do that. Weave. We use Weave as our, disclosure, we use Weave as our technology as our patient communication tool. It's our phone system, but it's also the way for us to communicate with our patients. And of course, we can communicate by phone, by text message, by email. But make sure you use that because now we can become very efficient. Let's say we pull a report from our practice management system, our practice management software, and we discovered that we've got these 400 patients that haven't been in, it's been a year or longer since they've been in for a hygiene appointment. And that wouldn't be unusual to see. Think how long it would take to reach those people by individual phone calls, even if all we're doing is leaving messages, versus imagine sending a group text, a group email to all 400 of those. Embrace technology. One more piece of technology that I would encourage you to take a look at is real-time scheduling, we use Local Med for that. There's others. In fairness, there's other systems, but that's where we could send a link in the email or in the text so that you can either call us and make your appointment like you always have, or you can just click on this link. This works especially well for hygiene appointments, because hygiene appointments are pretty straightforward. You know, doctor appointments are much more complicated because of the variance in the time and procedures and so on. So you could certainly use real-time appointment scheduling for doctor side, but you don't want to start there. You want to start with hygiene. Get your arms around it. And I'll simply tell you my satisfaction and happiness in working with Local Med. And again, to be fair, there are others. But use some kind of technology, because it's another way to get very efficient. And finally, this is an interesting, I have to tell this by way of parable, Naren. A number of years ago, we were struggling with some of those metrics. They weren't quite there. And I remember one month, and true confessions, Naren, I don't mind sharing the stumbles and the speed bumps. We had a month where we had 67 of the percent of the available hygiene appointments filled, 67. Naren, if 92 is an A, what's 67? Go ahead, I'm sitting down.
Close to an F, maybe an F.
Yeah, I mean, if you said D minus, I'd say you're grading on the soft curve. It's an F.
Yeah.
We were struggling with it. And my hygiene scheduling coordinator, so I decided to sit down with her, and I felt like we need to spend more time and effort on that. And I won't use her name, but I said, hey, how are we doing on reactivating past patients? And she said, and that was before we had the technology, she said, I've called everybody. Now, Naren, I had to muster my highest level of emotional intelligence to not respond in a non-emotionally intelligent way, because it's actually not possible to have reached everybody. But she said, I called everybody. I've already called everybody. I said, oh, okay. Awesome. Can you show me the list? Who did you call? And she pulls up this list. And let's say this month was September. She called all the patients that were due in September that weren't already reappointed. And that total in our practice that month was about 20 patients.
Hmm.
And so by her definition of everybody, she did call everybody. And by the way, out of those 20, you know, she got in about 15 of them, but we're still, you know, way under our goal. And so, oh, okay. Now I was beginning to understand the problem. I said, okay, but let me ask you a question. So that was people due in September. Did you go back and call the ones in August that never ended up appointing? Oh, you wanted me to call them? And then what about the ones in July?
Right.
What about the ones in June? And at that point, we were both laughing. And I mean, playfully, she goes, and as I'm doing that, she said, I haven't remotely even contacted everybody, have I? I said, not even remotely. And again, this is not a lazy person. Yeah. This is someone that had a different perception of what her resources were, what the job was. You know, and she said, I haven't even come close to that. But then she said, I do have one question, Gary. And this is the part that I want to get to. She said, I don't want to pester people. What guidelines should I use? When do I cross the line of being helpful and courteous and patients appreciating it and me crossing the line? I said, you know what? We were a solo doctor at the time. So I said, I'm going to sit down with Dr. Paul and we're going to come up with an answer on that, because you ask a great question. Paul and I sat down. Here's what we came up with. We think that we can communicate with any patient once a month until they either make an appointment or they say, quit pestering me. And in all the time we've done this, we've never heard the patient say, quit pestering me. So what's the answer? Contact them every month. And then the question becomes, how far back do you go? How far back do you go? Think about it, Naren. If someone has to make phone calls, and this takes a tremendous amount of time, we might want to have a limit to how far back they go, because it might not be the best return on that time.
Yeah.
But if in fact we can send an email or text, you can go back much farther. Now, I think there is a practical element of at what point are we just chasing after people that are long gone? But again, I'll run that playful thing that I said before about if someone saw you in the grocery store and they haven't been in your office in 5 years, might they still think of you as their dentist?
Absolutely.
They might. So that's the last tip is create a system to reach out to every past due hygiene patient once a month until they either make an appointment or they tell you to quit pestering. And I'm telling you, if you do it right in a spirit of helpfulness, they're not going to say, quit pestering me, because they're going to say, they might say, I'm really busy right now and I'm distracted, but thank you so much for reaching out, and they appreciate it. So those are the five strategies to use.
That's one of the advantages of healthcare, right? I mean, you are not a Nordstrom or a store trying to sell them a dress. You're not, you are like essential. You are health. So nobody sees you as a negative thing when you call them. And as long as I know you're going to cover this in the verbal skills, Gary, or one of the questions, as long as you use the right, language, I think people see you as you are doing them a favor by making sure that they don't, ruin their health or not take care of their health.
And doctor, if you're listening to this thinking, Gary, I know I'm on board with hygiene driven, but I got to tell you, I struggle with, having to do too many hygiene checks every hour. I can do two, but I can't do three. If you're thinking that, we're going to talk about that in the Q&A segment. And I think you're going to find a really, really cool win-win solution for growing your hygiene department that doesn't put an overburden on you for those checks. So stay tuned.
In today's Thriving Dentist Ask Gary segment, we have five questions from all across the U.S., Let me jump in and ask you, Gary, the very first question. Who should make the next hygiene appointment for our patients, the hygienist or a front desk team member?
That's a great question. Whoever sent that in, thanks so much. That's a great question. The answer is actually either could do that. However, I like the hygienist to make the next hygiene appointment in the treatment room right there. And there's a couple reasons for that. Number one is that there's a lot of activity that goes on at the front desk, and anytime we can decentralize tasks off of the business office and have it handled by another department, then it makes our business office more efficient. Now, I'm not assuming, I want to come to the defense of our hygienists real quick. I'm not assuming our hygienists are sitting around and have plenty of time on their hands. You're very busy too. But it doesn't take very long for you to make that next hygiene appointment right there in your treatment room. Now, the second reason is actually maybe more important. And that is that the hygienist has the authority and credibility to make the next hygiene appointment as their caregiver, as their provider of care. And the hygienist can say some things that the hygienist has the authority that a business team may not. And Aaron, I'm going to use you as an example. Is it okay if I use you as an example on this? And I'll role play as I'm Kelly, the hygienist. So and let me just kind of set it up a little bit. Let's say that because of your oral health, we like to see you every 4 months. But in fact, it's been 9 months since your last visit because life got in the way. Very realistic, right, Naren?
Yes.
But now Kelly's going to say to you, hey, Naren, I want to make your next hygiene appointment. Well, I have you right here. Let's go ahead and make it. And maybe your first reaction is that, oh, I don't know, Kelly. I don't always know my schedule that far in advance. That's a fair thing to say, right?
Yeah.
Now Kelly's going to say, I get it, Naren, but here's why I'd like to make it. It's been 9 months since your last hygiene visit. I like to see you every 4 months because of the condition of your gums. I'd see every 4 months. And let's face it, today's hygiene appointment was a little more difficult for both of us because of the amount of time that's elapsed since the last one. To avoid that, let's go ahead and make that appointment right now. And again, I wouldn't take it any farther than that. So if you were still resistant, I wouldn't pound a square peg in a round hole. But so let's just say, no, I just don't, unless I'm in front of my computer, I can't do that. Naren, I get it. We'll contact you before then. And let me encourage you to be really faithful about making that next appointment when we contact you. But hopefully we could actually make the appointment for you right there. And I think the hygienist has some authority and some credentialing that allows her to say some things clinically that a front desk team member just doesn't have that clout. Does that make sense, Darren?
Absolutely, Gary. Let me jump into the next one. I was taught that we should make the next hygiene appointment for 100% of our hygiene patients. Is that thinking still valid?
I'm laughing because I might have been the person that shared that 100% goal with our listener. Why is that? Because in 1982, I was the guy that said, back in 1982, you got to remember how we did, hygiene recare. We sent postcards out. We had the patients self-address them. And we sent postcards and said, time to make your appointment. Call us. That's what was done. And I said, nonsense. First of all, postage is expensive. We don't need to do that. We should just make their next appointment while they're there in front of you. We had the big appointment book. You had to flip out 6 months. We didn't have computerized scheduling. We had big appointment books. But we could just pull it out. And, if this was March, we're making your next appointment for September. And we go ahead and make it and put it. And then we'd make an appointment card where we'd fill out the day and the time. We'd hand you the appointment card and we'd hand you a magnet and say, Naren, here's the appointment reminder. Here's the magnet. Put this on your fridge. We're still going to confirm, but now we've got you all set up for September. And I said, and I taught this for 25 years. Nobody should leave your office without making their next hygiene appointment. Nobody. Nobody. Now, I changed when in 2007, I bought a practice. So 25 years, I taught that. Shortly after we bought the practice, we're having some holes in hygiene. And I went to my hygiene scheduling coordinator and I said, man, we're having a lot of holes. And she said, yeah, I knew George wasn't coming. And I said, if you knew George wasn't coming, why did you make an appointment for him? She said, because you told me to. Guilty as charged. I was the guy that said, no one leaves their office without their next appointment. And so we changed that. What we've learned with science and data behind us, in the population, about 90% of the people in the world are faithful enough about keeping an appointment you make 3, 4, or 6 months in advance. About 90% you can do that. So of the 10% that you just know, they can't remember their name after lunch, don't pound a square peg in the round hole. Use a different system for that. But the goal is 90%, so it's not 100. So doctor, to answer your question very specifically, is that still thinking still valid? No. The new number is 90%. New science, the new math is now 90%.
Thank you, Gary. That's a great answer. What are the best verbal skills to use when encouraging our patients to make their next hygiene appointment? Well, this, I think, is going to be like a viral clip that's going to get passed around.
I've got to answer that two ways because I said I would do it. I like to be honorable. I said I would do it. So I'm going to answer the best verbal skills, and I'm also going to tell you what never to say. What never to say.
Gary, is it okay if we put it into a PDF and share it as a
link? Please. I would love that. I would absolutely love that. So we'll put a link to that in the show notes. You can get the show notes at thrivingdentist.com and grab that PDF and share it with your team. So let me kind of frame it a little bit first. You always want to make sure that we have some kind of a benefit statement when we're asking the patient to do something, some kind of a benefit statement about why we want to make their next appointment. Did you notice the benefit statement when I was using you in the previous question? What was the benefit statement? Hey, Naren, we had both you and I had kind of
exactly.
a challenging an appointment today. To right. avoid that, That's a benefit statement.
Right.
So here's the benefit statement we could use when we're making an appointment. I'm role playing as the hygienist, and let's just say my patient's name is Maria. Hey, Maria, before you leave today, I want to go ahead and make your next hygiene appointment for you. And we know, Maria, if we see you on a regular basis, we accomplish two things. We keep you as healthy as possible, and we reduce your future dental expenses. So let's go ahead and make that appointment right now. Now, let's use other examples, Naren, because it's not necessarily a one-size-fits-all. Now, in our office, we have some prime-time hygiene appointments. For us, it's 7 o'clock and 8 o'clock in the morning, our prime time. We're open 7 to 4 Monday through Thursday, 7 to 2 on Friday. So 7 and 8 are prime time because they're generally outside of business hours. And let's say Bob loves the 7 o'clock appointment. What's the benefit statement I'm going to use? Watch this. Hey, Bob, let's go ahead and make your next hygiene appointment. I know you love that 7 o'clock appointment time, Bob, and so does a lot of other people. A lot of other people like that slot too. Let's grab it now so we can get the time that works best for you. The benefit statement?
Brilliant. So,
let's put both of those in the in the PDF document. Now, as I promised, what never to say, and I've heard this come out of so many people's mouths, and it's not bad. It's kind of a natural phrase. Hey, Naren, let's go ahead and make your next appointment. You can always change it later if you want. Never, never, never say that. Because what have I just done? And Aaron, let's say the patient say, I don't know. I don't have my appointment. I don't have my electronic scheduler. Naren, let's go ahead and make it. We can always change it later. I've devalued that appointment.
Yes.
You can change it. You can come. You cannot come. I just devalued it.
Yeah. I love that.
Never say you can always, because we're trying to get people to be faithful about keeping their appointments.
Exactly.
I think when people say that, the other word I hear a lot that I would like to eliminate is the word just, J-U-S-T, before a hygiene. It's just a hygiene appointment. What have I just done with that qualifier word, just?
You have devalued it again.
Devalued it. So be mindful of the words that we use. And if someone says, I don't know what I'm doing, then think about the benefit statement that applies to them. It might be the time slot. Here we go. Naren, there's this guy I know in marketing, Robert Cialdini.
Yes.
And he's created 6 fundamental principles of influence. There's influence. There's one of the 6 that isn't as readily used in dentistry. What is one of the, I'm quizzing you because we didn't talk about this ahead of time. Of the
scarcity.
6, scarcity.
Yeah.
But it works here. Let me share what I mean by that. Naren said, I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing in 6 hours, let alone, 6 months. Right. Hey, Naren, I get it. Sometimes my life feels like that too, but you know what? Let's get an appointment for you now. Because if we don't grab an appointment for you, we may not be able to find the time that's going to work best for you. Let's grab it now. Scarcity, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Someone else is going to want it. So now we use scarcity.
Right.
Yeah. So these are easy to implement, easy to use.
I know you teach techniques like this all day long to your coaching clients. So I think I appreciate you giving it for free for the listeners of the Thriving Dentist Show, Gary. Appreciate it.
Yeah, you know, these phrases can be powerful and they really do help for sure.
Let me go to the next question. I'm a solo dentist practicing 4 days per week, and I have a hygienist who works 4 days per week. I have had the same schedule for the last 8 years. Is there a way for me to know when I have enough demand to add more hygiene days in my practice?
What a thank you, doctor, for your transparency, for your candor, and your honesty in that question. So let's break that down. Let's unpack that. Last 8 years, no growth in hygiene. I'm going to use an interesting adjective. Doctor, you have a constipated practice. Now, isn't that a graphic image that we don't need? You have a constipated practice. Think about all the new patients that have come in your practice since then. Now, I don't know what this doctor's new patient numbers are, Naren, because it wasn't shared in the question. I don't know. But hypothetically, let's say it was 20 new patients a month, just hypothetically.
That's around 1,800 patients in 8 years.
And you've not grown hygiene days?
Wow.
So we're asleep at the wheel, doctor, of you being your champion of your patient's oral health. They're just out there floating around in Netherland, right?
Yeah.
So think about that for just a minute. So I appreciate your candor because you want to change. You want to make a difference moving forward. And the specific question is there a way for me to know when I have enough demand to add more hygiene days in my practice? And the answer is yes, a very easy one. there's multiple ways, but let me share with you one of them. One of them is to look at that kept hygiene appointment ratio. When you're at 92% or more kept hygiene appointment, we likely have the demand to add another day. Because that's an indication that, you know, when we have an opening, they're able to fill it with the call list, you know, that sort of thing. You have the ability to add it. And you know, you can go cautiously at this. You don't have to add another full-time hygienist. Maybe the way we add hygiene is we add another day. Mm-hmm. So maybe we go from 4 days a week, to 5, to 6, to 7, to 8. Remember, I have a bias here. I am a big-time advocate of a hygiene-driven practice. The more activity you have in hygiene, doctor, the stronger your practice is. So I want to keep growing that. Now, you want slight tension when you add days. You want to have to stretch a little bit to fill it, but not, you don't want to add so much time in hygiene that you've got no ability to come close to that 92% filled. So, Nair, let's say that you know you can fill one more day a week and you think you could fill two. And you've got the perfect hygiene candidate that would love to work for you 2 days a week. Mm-hmm. I would take a flyer and put two on it. And I would take a chance on that. And let's say by taking a chance, by stretching a little bit, it meant that I can only fill 90% of the available hygiene appointments, 89%, 88%. I'd be okay with that because we're trending in the right direction. Does that make sense, Naren?
Yes, it does.
Yeah. Instead of when you add, you knew you could add a day. Now you add a day and you're still at 92% filled. You really had more capacity. And if you have the perfect person to put in there, don't miss that opportunity. There's opportunity cost. Don't miss that opportunity.
Right.
But you want to grow hygiene. I've looked ahead to see the next question, which kind of relates to this, of course. But yeah, any chance you get to grow hygiene, I'm going to be a cheerleader for that because of the positive effects that happen, the positive byproducts that happen from all that in your practice.
Let me ask the last question, Gary. I totally get the value of a hygiene-driven practice, but I struggle with managing the hygiene exams. I currently have 2 hygienists each day, and I have room and the demand to add more hygiene days. But I'm not excited about doing 3 hygiene exams per hour. Any suggestions?
Oh, wow. That one, I think every dentist listening to that, that question struck a nerve. That question struck. And I want to be tremendously empathetic. I get it, doc. Now, Grant, I'm not a dentist. I've never had to do 3 hygiene exams an hour, but trust me, I get it. I get it. You know, you're trying to be a relationship driven practice. You're providing restorative dentistry and you're getting to a different patient. And now you have to get up 3 times an hour and you're thinking, I'm just concerned that the patient on my restorative side, and maybe even you've got another room on restorative and you're thinking, they're going to think, what am I, a second class citizen? Mm-hmm. You got to get up. What am I, you know, chopped liver? Yeah, I get it. I get it. I have a wonderful client. It's a mutual client of ours. We both know him, Naren. And this client says, if it wasn't for all these darn hygiene exams, I could get some work done around here. And I get it. And we both laugh about that because if it wasn't for all these darn hygiene exams, he wouldn't have future treatment on his schedule.
Right.
So he gets it. He gets it. And so I want to get real tactical here. 4 days a week, we have triple hygiene. We have one doc with three hygienists. And in the morning huddle, as we're going through our morning huddle, one of the things we identify in the morning huddle is we try to identify one patient an hour who doesn't need a hygiene exam. Most dentists feel like they could do 2 hygiene exams. It's when we get to 3 that, you know, it's the straw that breaks the camel's back. So we try to find one an hour that doesn't need a hygiene. It might be a perio maintenance patient, of course, or it could be a healthy adult with no unscheduled treatment. If it's a healthy adult, but they have unscheduled treatment, then we want to see them because we want to reinforce that unscheduled treatment plan. And generally, we could find one an hour. We give up the revenue from the hygiene exam. We don't play any games with, you know, saying we did an exam. No, we have high integrity with everything we do. If we don't do an exam, we don't do it. Now, I will say that I teach my clients to pop their head in the room and say hello. Hey, Naren, it's Dr. Paul. I knew you were here in hygiene today. Kelly tells me everything's looking great. I just wanted to say hello. Good to see you today. That's not an exam. That's a meet and greet.
Right.
You know, and we can do that. And that you generally can be done, you know, and not have the patient in your chair feel like they're getting second treatment. And you can cover it up with a smoke screen. Imagine a doctor saying, Naren, imagine you're my restorative patient. Hey, Naren, we're at a good point to kind of rest your jaw. I want you to close your mouth. I'm going to pop the chair up so you can get a little more comfortable. We're at a good point. Take a little rest. I'll be right back. So you can kind of smoke screen a little bit. Yeah. The other thing
I got one more tip.
The other thing I would say is that oral conscious sedation, whenever you could do sedation dentistry, oral conscious sedation is a great tool because with oral conscious sedation, we use it. It's a practice builder. You can get up 3 times an hour to do an exam. A patient doesn't even know you left the room. With oral conscious sedation, they're conscious, but they're in a kind of a foggy state. So they respond to your commands, turn left, turn right, you know, open wider for me. They just don't remember it. And they're in this kind of twilight state. But honest to gosh, you can get up 3 times an hour. And I love oral conscious sedation. Now, again, I can do that, you know, on every patient. But for our longer appointments, that's a great way to manage this as well. Those questions are outstanding. You know, as we kind of come into the finish line here, one of the 10 elements of a thriving practice, one of the 10 is to have a hygiene-driven practice. Doctors, if you liked what you've heard on this episode and you're thinking you might like some help, maybe you're an office that has 16% of your total production coming from hygiene. I'd love to see you in our coaching program because, man, we are seeing radical changes in those 4 metrics that we talked about in the coaching and action segment. And our coaching is helping guide you and your team to actually implement all the things that we're talking about. So maybe you could think of this podcast episode as, you know, the appetizer that gets you curious about it. Our coaching can actually help you achieve that. So to do that, we'll put a link in the show notes. It's our coaching program. Simply click that link. You've kind of got 2 options. One, if you're ready to go, just hit get started. And we'll get started with you. If there's spots available, if you go to the website and it says no spots currently available, we are currently full. We do limit the number of clients we work with because of the intensity of the support we provide. If there are spaces available, it will show there. Secondly, maybe you'd like to talk to me about it and really determine if it's a good fit. If that's the case, you can schedule a coaching strategy meeting with me. It'll be a phone call with me. And we'll sit down and you and I will determine if it's the right fit. If it's not, I will be very candid and share with you. If it is, I'd invite you to come join us. So there you go. And hey, as we're finishing up here, I want to thank our listeners. We sure appreciate each and every one of you. And a couple places that you can go to support our work, go to Google Play to subscribe or go to iTunes to subscribe. That helps us, and that's a way that you can give back to us. On that note, let me thank you for the privilege of your time today and tell you that Naren and I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.